in the hearts of men.
To some, it was a miracle. Others called it the triumph of illiteracy. Radio, it revolutionized the way people learned about their world.
Oh my, get out of the way, please.
It changed forever the way people would be entertained.
You gotta straighten out that closet one of these days.
Now, out of thin air, the invention of radio on Modern Marvels.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
On December 8th, 1941, 60 million Americans tuned in their radios to hear President Franklin Delano Roosevelt ask Congress to declare war against Japan.
Empire of Japan.
On that day in 1941, radio occupied a position at the very center of American life. People relied on it for information, entertainment, very often religion, and as a lifeline to a world around them. No one knew the power of radio better than Roosevelt, who had used the medium so effectively to reassure Americans during the dark days of the Depression. Now once again, they listen to the familiar voice of their radio president in living rooms, offices, automobiles, restaurants, grocery markets, or gas stations. Radio was everywhere. It was taken for granted. Yet just a few short decades before, it didn't exist. Most people credit Guillermo Marconi with inventing the radio, and he is recognized as the inventor of the wireless telegraph, filing for his patent in 1896. But brilliant scientist though he was, Marconi had many collaborators in that he was the beneficiary and exponent of centuries of research in the field of magnetic electricity. In a sense, Marconi may have discovered radio, but previous discoveries by a host of scientists and great thinkers had given him a good idea where to look. Man's desire to wage war created the need to communicate quickly over distance and thereby gain advantage over the enemy. Medieval knights reflected sunlight on their shields as signals. Napoleon soldiers rallied to trumpet and drum. Native American Indians exchanged smoke signals, while American colonists communicated with flags. In the early part of the 19th century, the discovery and development of the electromagnet made telegraphy, communication over wire, scientifically possible. In 1835, Samuel Morse sent his first message in dots and dashes over telegraph wire from Washington to Baltimore. What hath God wrought? By the beginning of the Civil War, the same country that was about to divide itself in conflict north against south had been stitched together east to west with the completion of a transcontinental telegraph wire. 2 years after the close of the war, a transatlantic cable was laid. Not long after the telegraph lines went up, scientists became aware that electrical current was leaking from the wires and magnetizing metallic objects at a considerable distance. The reason for this remained a mystery until 1856, when James Clerk Maxwell, an English physicist, offered mathematical proof that electrical impulses travel through space in the form of waves. These electromagnetic waves, he wrote, were similar in form and equal in speed to the velocity of light.
Well, I think the history of radio starts with a man named Clerk Maxwell in the 19th century, who really stands as one of the most important physicists of all time, and really as important as Newton. Clerk Maxwell postulated the existence of electromagnetic waves, which of course are responsible not only for sound, but for all of the light that we have around us.
In 1887, Heinrich Hertz, a young German scientist, attempted to apply Maxwell's theory. He fashioned an apparatus that had two metal balls separated by a narrow gap. He connected this device to a coil of wire, a battery, a switch, and a Leyden jar, a device for storing electricity. With the flick of a switch, Hertz caused electrons to jump the gap between the balls by alternating the polarity of the balls from negative to positive. Hertz called this device an oscillator because the spark oscillated or switched back and forth continuously as long as the alternating current was maintained. Experimenting further, Hertz attached a metal ball to each end of a length of wire. He fashioned the wire into a loop but left a narrow gap at the ends. He then placed the wire loop near but not touching the oscillator. When he turned the oscillator circuit on, a spark jumped between the gap and the loop. How could this happen, Hertz wondered, when the loop and the oscillator were not even connected? The answer, Hertz speculated, lay in the existence of electromagnetic waves. These waves had traveled through the air from the oscillator to the spark. This simple experiment was the first radio transmission. Hertz's oscillator had been the transmitter, and his wire loop had been the receiver. 5 years later, 18-year-old Guillermo Marconi read of Hertz's accomplishments and saw instantly the commercial possibilities of wireless communication, especially in the shipping industry. He turned the third floor of his family home into a workshop, read everything he could get his hands on relative to Hertzian waves, and sought to take up where Hertz and others had left off.
His parents had a very large estate in Italy. His mother was a Jameson from the Irish Whiskey Company. And when Marconi could not get the Italian government interested in his wireless telegraphy, his mother took him to London and connected him with the British postal authorities. And they saw the potential of what wireless telegraphy would do and immediately snapped up the patent.
Though untrained as a scientist, Marconi was able through trial and error to increase the efficiency of Hertz's oscillator. Then he added a grounded antenna, which he found strengthened the waves, although he didn't know why. Later, he determined that by raising his antenna, he could increase his transmitting range. By the time Marconi was settled in England, he had transmitted Morse code without wires, an astounding 9 miles. In 1898, he transmitted the results of a yacht race from a tugboat, allowing newspapers to print stories of the race before the yachts had returned to shore. Ship owners began to purchase wireless systems and install them on their vessels. On March 27, 1899, Marconi sent a wireless signal across the English Channel to France. Overshadowing some of Marconi's success, at least in his own mind, was the fact that he thought in order to be a success, wireless had to be private. The telegraph and the fledgling telephone were private, connecting only a single caller and receiver. But wireless could be picked up by anyone with a receiver. Privacy, he felt, was the key to success in communications. But before signals could be isolated, they would have to be distinguished one from the other. In England, Sir Oliver Lodge had patented a plan for regulating the wavelength of the transmitter and tuning the receiver to pick up only that wavelength. Marconi bought the patent from him. As the new century dawned, the air was filled with wireless signals. But these consisted only of dots and dashes. In 1901, the first transatlantic messages were exchanged by wireless. 4 years later, the SS Arapaho used for the first time the international distress call SOS. Soon afterward, the entire U.S. Navy was equipped with Marconi's equipment. On Christmas Eve in 1906, professional and amateur wireless operators in the area of Brant Rock, Massachusetts, picked up a transmission they would never forget. Instead of the usual dots and dashes, they heard human voices and the strains of a violin playing an old Christmas hymn. The sender of this transmission was a scientist named Reginald Aubrey Fessenden.
When Fessenden first played his violin on Christmas Eve, and the signal operators at first heard this music coming out on their earphones. Can you imagine? They thought there was some kind of magic was happening.
What Fessenden did was he imprinted a voice on a radio wave. And he did this by creating, with the help of General Electric Company and a man named Ernst Alexanderson, something called the Alexanderson alternator, which was essentially an electric generator that moved so fast that it created not just electricity, but electromagnetic waves.
Pheasanton used a carbon microphone to convert his voice into an audio signal. His transmission technique was called amplitude modulation, or AM, because it modulated or controlled the amplitude or height of the wave. Pheasanton's Christmas Eve transmission introduced a new concept to the world, a transmission intended for anyone who could hear it, a broadcast. And since this new concept suggested an image of waves radiating outward in all directions from a central point, the term radio was born. The grand collaboration had resulted in history's most stunning achievement in the field of communications. But here's where the cooperation ended. From this point, radio would no longer be a curiosity, a tinkerer's fancy. Overnight, it would become big business with fortunes to be made or grabbed. The coming decade would see bitter rivalries emerge in the struggle to control this new medium. It would see the rise of the powerful media corporation and the demise of the individual inventor. There are nearly twice as many radios in the U.S. as there are people. Radio will continue in a moment on Modern Marvels.
There's really been no easy way to remove a stripped screw until now. It's the innovative Craftsman Screw-Out Damaged Screw Removers. Available only from Sears, it's the fast, easy way to remove damaged screws. Unlike ordinary screwdrivers or driver bits, the Craftsman Screw-Out Damaged Screw Removers are able to dig in, get that needed resistance, and twist the screw out. It's made of heavy-duty steel, and it can work with either a drill or a hand driver. So call now. Get three different sized bits and case for only $19.99. Or head over to Sears. With this tool, you can take on almost any screw. Phillips, slotted, Torx, hex, even works on rusted screws. Painted over screws, too. Yep, Craftsman makes anything possible. Craftsman Screw-Out Damaged Screw Removers, the easy way out. Call now and order yours for only $19.99.
To order your set of three Craftsman Screw-Out Damaged Screw Removers, have your credit card ready and call 1-800-447-8585.
IBM ThinkPad. Real people, not actors. Have you seen the new IBM ThinkPad?
This is nice. This is light.
It's a lot lighter.
It's slick. It's manageable. It's easy to carry.
Do you travel for your work?
I'm on a plane about every week.
They got a little light there for your keyboard.
Well, I'm loving this little red button here in the center.
That's the mouse.
Oh, that's the mouse?
I want something that's not only efficient but reliable.
All of these computers can use Rapid Restore. That lets you go back to the last time the computer saved.
So it's almost like backing up your computer every day.
They have a thing called the Ultra Bay Plus. You can put a CD-ROM. You can put a DVD.
I love this thing. I think I felt like the IBM was more expensive.
Actually, this ThinkPad notebook starts at just $11.99. It has a mobile Intel Pentium 4 processor M to help make your business more productive. Buy yours with the mobile Intel Pentium 4 processor M today, and you can get this port replicator free, making it easier to connect multiple devices.
Would you know how to buy an IBM computer?
I would guess IBM.com.
If I were younger, and if I were more on the ball, I'd get one of these.
If you have a tax problem or owe money to the IRS, please stay tuned for some important information. The IRS is now reconciling back-owed taxes, liens, levies, payroll taxes, even penalties. If you act now, the Seidemann Law Firm can settle your IRS debt for just pennies on the dollar. Don't wait until it's too late. Call the Seidemann Law Firm now and settle your IRS problems for only pennies on the dollar. Don't be another IRS victim. Call today for a free confidential tax analysis.
Call toll-free now, 1-800-354-3400.
We now return to radio on Modern Marvels. Pheasanton's broadcast had sent radio technology spinning off in a new direction, and soon inventors and wireless operators alike were experimenting with ways to more effectively broadcast the human voice. But a better, smaller generator and a more sophisticated receiver were needed. Early receivers contained mineral rocks called crystals. These change the alternating current of the incoming wave into direct current, allowing the sound to be heard. Crystal sets, as they were called, were inexpensive and popular. But since they operated solely off the lower power generated by the incoming signal, the operator had to wear headphones to hear anything. One of Marconi's technical advisors, John Ambrose Fleming, realized that building bigger generators was not the key to improve radio transmitters and receivers. Inspired by Edison's light bulb and the work of English scientist J.J. Thomson involving electrons, Fleming built a glass valve or diode, which was the forerunner of the vacuum tube. This diode used the power of the electron rather than the mechanical device to capture radio waves. In 1906, inventor Lee DeForest modified Fleming's diode to create a new device which amplified the audio signal, making it easier to hear. It was the first electronic amplifier. He called it the Audion tube.
And he made the invention that changed the world, and that was the radio tube as we know it today. But the curious thing is, Lee DeForest didn't understand what he had invented.
In 1911, a 21-year-old electrical engineer named Edwin Howard Armstrong began to study DeForest's Audion tube. He determined that electrons within moved back and forth or oscillated in a steady rhythm. This current could be fed back into the system to be amplified again, thereby greatly increasing the power of the signal. This principle became known as feedback or regeneration and remains a basic principle of radio today. With Armstrong's innovation, large, expensive generators could be replaced by small vacuum tubes. Radio became more practical. On the night of April 14, 1912, the luxury steamship Titanic collided with an iceberg in the North Atlantic and began to sink. The operator of the ship's Marconi wireless system tapped out a desperate call for help. The liner Carpathia picked up the signal and came to the rescue in time to save 711 passengers. But 1,513 others had already perished in the icy water. For the next few days, a shocked world received news of the tragedy via wireless. As each passenger was accounted for, the world heard about it. In Nantucket, Massachusetts, a young wireless operator for the Marconi Company, David Sarnoff, remained at his key for 72 hours, receiving news of the tragedy from the rescue ship Carpathia as she approached New York. Sarnoff, a Russian immigrant with only an eighth grade education, had secured a position with the Marconi Company in New York, becoming the inventor's personal errand boy. His subsequent post as key operator at one of Marconi's land stations had put him in the right place at the right time. The Titanic tragedy had underscored the importance of radio to humankind in time of emergency. But David Sarnoff recognized radio's potential as a business. In 1916, now a young executive, Sarnoff wrote a lengthy memo to the president of American Marconi, wherein he outlined what he perceived to be the medium's future.
I have in mind a plan of development which would make radio a household utility. The idea is to bring music into the home by wireless. The receiver can be designed in the form of a simple radio music box and arranged for several different wavelengths, which should be changeable with the throwing of a single switch or pressing of a single button. Also, events of national importance can be simultaneously announced and received.
Premeditated invasion.
Baseball scores can be transmitted in the air. This proposition would be especially interesting to farmers and others living in outlying districts. Sincerely yours, David Sarnoff.
As the specter of World War loomed on America's horizon, the fledgling radio industry was already engaged in a war of its own. Powerful corporations dueled in court for the patents that would allow them to gain a stranglehold on the new medium. No more would inventors be permitted to freely adapt or build upon the work of others for the good of all humanity. Radio was now a product that could be sold, and there was money to be made. America's entry into World War I actually helped the radio industry. The government declared a moratorium on patent suits and resolved disputes by pooling the patents and allowing all companies to draw from the pool. This allowed the industry to concentrate on development and manufacturing instead of their legal squabbles. Soon radios were standardized and mass-produced to meet wartime demand. While serving with the Army in Europe, Edwin Howard Armstrong continued his research into high-frequency radio waves. The result of his work was a more efficient radio receiver he called a superheterodyne. The superheterodyne improved radio reception by narrowing the frequency range handled by amplifiers. This helped eliminate unwanted electrical interference while still boosting the radio signal. Armstrong's superheterodyne, though complex in circuitry, was simple to operate. With just one knob for volume and one for tuning, it was the first modern radio receiver. At the end of the war, the U.S. government understood how important radio had become and moved to keep the industry from slipping into foreign hands. The Radio Corporation of America was formed with General Electric as the parent company. The patents and assets of American Marconi were transferred to the new company. In return, British Marconi could continue to buy American parts for the equipment it manufactured and sold to the rest of the world. Most of American Marconi's employees, including David Sarnoff, moved to RCA. David Sarnoff still harbored his dream of selling radio music boxes for use in private homes. But another company, Westinghouse, beat him to his goal. Westinghouse had purchased the exclusive rights to Armstrong's superheterodyne receiver, and now they determined their best entry would be to broadcast programming from radio towers and then sell the receivers to the public. Westinghouse chose Dr. Frank Conrad to build a radio station on the roof of its factory in Pittsburgh. Station KDKA went on the air November 2, 1920, broadcasting the presidential election returns.
Broadcast as soon as they are received by us here at KDKA.
The broadcast was a huge success. Sales of radio receivers skyrocketed. In short order, KDKA and other stations began broadcasting church services. And then boxing matches. Radio took off and never looked back. Up until now, communications companies had made their money through two-way communications charges like the telegraph, telephone, and now the wireless, or through the sale of radio equipment. On August 28, 1922, WEAF in New York broadcast an advertisement for an apartment building. It was the first paid radio commercial. Suddenly, a new world of enterprise appeared at radio's door.
Henry!
Advertising.
Henry Aldrich! Coming, Mother!
Radio broadcasting networks were formed when the Federal Trade Commission ruled that RCA, AT&T, and other companies had created a monopoly in the new industry. The national broadcasting company, NBC, was formed from RCA and Westinghouse in 1926. And the Columbia Broadcasting Service followed in 1929. Both networks were permitted to use AT&T's phone lines to connect their transmitters. The networks allowed people throughout the country to hear broadcasts simultaneously. Overnight, radio began to affect every American life as no other technological influence ever had. The sale of radio sets grew so fast that the manufacturers were hard-pressed to keep up with demand.
Radio made the world smaller just that fast, because it could be transmitted so quickly, and you didn't have to wait for the newspapers to let you know what was happening.
In January 1925, 15 million people heard Calvin Coolidge's inaugural speech on their radios. So many advertisers flocked to the new medium that some newspaper chains panicked and refused to carry radio listings or even mention the word radio in their pages. In 1927, the first coast-to-coast program was broadcast on NBC. It was the Rose Bowl football game. Probably the biggest radio event of the 20s was Charles A. Lindbergh's historic solo flight across the Atlantic.
This is WJZ, New York. As Saturday dawned over the vast Atlantic, the Lindbergh plane is unreported since passing Newfoundland early last night.
Socially, it made a big difference. Somebody who was a farmer in Kansas could be knowing the same things that somebody on Wall Street was hearing.
Each year, the quality of radio programming improved and the number of shows multiplied. performers and personalities heretofore unknown to a wide public found themselves thrust into the national spotlight overnight. Names like Milton Cross, Harold Arlen, Ed Wynn, Guy Lombardo and his Royal Canadians, Gertrude Berg, and Will Rogers became familiar in households all over the country.
Mr. Splablato will announce...
Entertainment itself was changing to fit the new medium. Billy Jones and Ernie Hare were the first team to emerge from vaudeville to star on radio with their simple harmonies and satirical humor. They billed themselves as the Happiness Boys.
Once upon a time.
As the decade drew to a close, David Sarnoff at NBC and his new young rival at CBS, William Paley, were drawing lines on the battlefield of radio.
At that time, CBS, when I first joined them, they were like a family network. NBC was a big power. And they were not going to try to compete. They didn't have anybody to put up against Bob Hope. They would have had to have Jack Benny or Fred Allen. But NBC had them both. It was not many years before William Paley raided NBC and got Jack Benny away from them. And then the picture changed, you know.
In 1929, the stock market crash pitched the nation headlong into a Great Depression. There would be dark days ahead for America, and she would turn to her new best friend, the radio, to see her through. In the 1930s, the Amos and Andy show was so popular that many movie theaters stopped their films from 7 to 7:15 and turned on the radio so the audience could listen to the program. Radio will continue in a moment on Modern Marvels.
They turned the tide of the Revolutionary War. Their stealth and skill have turned every battle since.
I'm not some crazy person. I'm out there in defense of my country.
Josh Binswanger looks at this controversial aspect of military training. Snipers. All this week at 9, 8 Central on the History Channel.
$395 per couple on winter packages.
Hi, Billy Mays here for OxiClean, the stain specialist. Activate the stain-removing power by adding warm water. Use OxiClean in a solution to take out spots and stains. It even takes grape juice out of your favorite cotton shirt. Chlorine bleach can damage your clothes. With just one splash, you can ruin a pair of jeans. OxiClean is odor-free and safe on your colored fabrics. OxiClean, the stain specialist. Use OxiClean on carpeting. It eliminates red wine, pet stains, and neutralizes odors. Iodine, coffee, red wine, on the clothes and in the water. Add OxiClean. It removes the stains without the damaging effects of chlorine. Call now and you'll get a whopping 4-pound bucket of OxiClean, the squirt bottle and the super chamois. Not $20, only $9.99. Here's how to order.
Call to order the 4-pound bucket of OxiClean for only $9.99. You'll also get the squirt bottle and super chamois with your order. Call 1-800-455-4848. Call now.
On September 11th, our lives changed forever. Matthew Malone lost a family member on Flight 11. As he watched the events unfold, Matthew wanted to do more. Then he learned about the United Day of Service. This September 11th, from Los Angeles to New York to our nation's capital, youth will unite to serve the needs of their community.
Change starts with one. This September 11th, what will you do?
Join Matthew and thousands of others in the United Day of Service.
We now return to radio on Modern Marvels. Radio couldn't lose. The stock market crash and advent of the Depression did nothing to cool America's ardor for the magic box with the dials on it. Theaters closed down. Nightclubs languished. Theatrical stock companies disappeared, but radio prospered.
Radio was very important in the Depression because it was cheap entertainment. If you didn't have the buck to go to the movie, you stayed at home and you heard some good stuff.
And Edwin, the fire chief!
Between 1930 and 1933, 4 million radios were sold in America. Now, why radio? Because what you bought was free entertainment, paid for by the commercials.
Who knows what evil lurks in the hearts of men? The shadow knows.
By 1930, network programming had assumed the shape it would retain for the next 20 years. The broadcast day was divided into quarter, half, and full hour segments. Programs and commercials were timed to the second. Radio's appetite for material was voracious. All the hours of the day and night needed to be filled. Syndication of scripts and ready-made programs to stations all over the country became big business and standardized the broadcast industry. Stations began to sound alike. Radio settled into a comfortable and perhaps complacent niche of the center of the culture. The networks were aware of the hold they had on the country's attention and were determined not to choke the golden goose. Radio produced stars no less in stature than ever pranced upon a Broadway stage or kissed on a Hollywood screen. America embraced these performers and personalities as if they were family, and in a way they were. You had to go to a theater to see movie stars, but a radio performer came right into your living room.
Just about 7 nights a week, I think, you could turn on your radio after 6:30 or 7 in the evening, and until about 11 be assured of really good entertainment.
Breakfast of Champions bring you the thrilling adventures of Jack Armstrong, the All-American Boy.
From Hollywood, the Jimmy Durante Show.
The makers of Instant Chase and Sanborn Coffee present the Charlie McCarthy Show.
Edgar Bergen and Charlie McCarthy. How could a ventriloquist work on the radio? Charlie was special. He was hysterical.
Well, we want equal billing and we want more money.
Every show was an experience. Every show, you look forward going to work. The sound effects men were there, the unsung heroes of early day radio. A good sound effects man could make or break it.
I gotta straighten out that closet one of these days.
They knew that they wanted to have something aside from a fiery horse with the speed of light, a cloud of dust, and a hearty... And Fran Stryker, who wrote the show, had written in, a hearty laugh. And this is 3 minutes before they're going on the air live. No, we can't have a laugh. What do we use? Well, can't he say something like cowboy, something, a cow, like yip, 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 yip? No, no, that doesn't. How about talking to his horse? Yeah. How about hi-o, 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 silver, away. That's it. So they ran into the studio, and that's the way it happened.
At least radio drama was aptly named. I don't know who coined the phrase, but the theater of the mind. And it's true. If 5 million people were listening, you were giving 5 million different performances because you were as each individual saw you. And that was the beauty of a vision.
And Lights Out was a show I listened to as a kid. It was a scary. It was scarier than In the Sanctum. It was scarier than Suspense. The announcer had a great voice, and it was on Sunday nights, and he would say, "Crawl under your couch, lock your doors, turn down the blinds, and turn your lights out." Now, you watching me do that is nothing, but listening to it.
It is the hour when dogs howl and evil is let loose on a sleeping world.
The radio listener is a participant. He becomes the set designer. He's in charge of wardrobe. It doesn't matter whether the soprano singing Carmen weighs 250 pounds. To the radio listener, she's a spirited, dangerous little woman with a rose in her teeth and wonderful legs.
In at least one dramatic instance, a radio drama stirred imaginations enough to cause panic in some communities. Orson Welles' Mercury Theater production of H.G. Wells' fantasy War of the Worlds was broadcast the night before Halloween in 1938.
We now return you to Carl Phillips at Grover's Mill.
Ladies and gentlemen, here I am. Wait a minute, something's happening. There's a jet of flame springing from the mirror, and it leaps right at the advancing men. Lord, they're turning into flames.
Well, I thought it was magnificent. I heard it, but and knew it was a broadcast. I couldn't quite understand this national hysteria and people rushing out to dig a hole, you know, to get in.
Orson Welles had just directed the famous War of the Worlds radio broadcast, the dramatic show that frightened millions of Americans into believing the country actually was being invaded by monsters from Mars.
You will think less of my intelligence when I tell you this, but I was one of the reportedly 17 million Americans who was panicked. The reason that so many were fooled, who were not ordinarily foolable, is that that great show was done in the form of news coverage. If so, that's why we believed it.
We are deeply shocked and deeply regretful of the results of last night's broadcast.
Sometimes the tragedies reported on radio were all too real.
Get it started. It's crashing. Terrible. Oh, my. Get out of the way, please. It's burning into flames and it's falling on the mooring fast.
I think the worst one that I ever heard, the most graphic one, was when the Hindenburg caught fire and burned, and the man stayed right there with it, and he described it with tears in his eyes and in his voice, the bodies that fell maybe 150 or 200 feet.
Arguably, the era's single most adept figure in exploiting the power and influence of radio was President Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
I am happy to speak to you from my home on a Sabbath day that has been observed in so many of your home communities as Brotherhood Day.
He talked to everybody without either talking down or up. And I think that he kept the notion of the nation tightly bound.
Let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. Nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror which paralyzes needed effort to convert retreat into advance.
America's dreams and hopes of peace died with 3,000 officers and men in the Holocaust at Pearl Harbor.
Radio's role in World War II was a very dramatic one, in that for the first time we were getting reports from correspondents abroad, live in the capitals, as the seeds of war began to grow and the menace increased. It was a very tense time, and we depended upon radio to bring us the latest.
World War II really added a new dimension to radio, and that was news.
The war also demonstrated the use of radio as a weapon. It was called propaganda. Her name was Eva Toguri Dakino, but they called her Tokyo Rose. During World War II, her radio broadcasts to American GIs became both famous and infamous. Radio kept the nation united and focused on the war effort. Entertainers took to the airwaves to rally support for the boys. As far back as 1933, Edwin Howard Armstrong had developed frequency modulation, or FM, as the answer to static. When America entered World War II, Armstrong petitioned the Army and Navy to adopt FM as the format for two-way communication systems. Staticless FM communication gave the Allies an advantage over the Germans with their AM walkie-talkies. FM helped win the war. Back home, the golden age of radio was going strong. Popular entertainers of the 40s included Frank Sinatra, Glenn Miller, Benny Goodman, Rosemary Clooney, Arthur Godfrey, Abbott and Costello, Burns and Allen, and Basil Rathbone as Sherlock Holmes. For the long-haired crowd, there was Arturo Toscanini with the NBC Symphony Orchestra.
The golden age of radio was the shortest golden age in history. And those who were working inside it were not aware that it was the golden age. They thought it would go on forever.
But forever was just around the corner. The end of World War II brought a new era of growth and prosperity to America, and radio occupied a position at the very center of the culture. She had no way of knowing it, but the wolf was at the door, and its name was television. There is a radio in over 70% of American bedrooms. Most of them are clock radios. Radio will continue in a moment on Modern Marvels.
Since the beginning of time, guys have been driven to get great stuff. And guys haven't changed. The coolest, the hottest, the fastest. Guys gotta have them. So what if it's a bit much? We still want them. And the History Channel's got them. From motorcycles to ultra-cool James Bond gadgets. Hey, it's a hormone thing. A week-long special to drool over. Modern Marvel's Boys Toys. Begins December 2nd on the History Channel. Got testosterone?
Hi, Billy Mays here for Orange Glow, wood cleaner and polish. Discover the secret of pure orange oil. It cleans, it polishes, and helps protect all at the same time. Use it on different types of wood, like cherry, oak, maple, and walnut. Wood dries out. Orange Glow helps keep it looking new. It puts down an invisible shield that helps protect your wood from water spots and stains. Orange Glow leaves a smooth surface and a lustrous shine. Other cleaners don't always cut the grease. Orange Glow wipes away this grease pencil without damaging the surface. When you call, you'll get not one, but two bottles of our Orange Glow. We'll also include a bottle of our multi-purpose cleaner, Orange Clean. You get all this, not $20, only $12.99. Here's how to order.
Call now and for only $12.99, you get not one, but two 16-ounce bottles of the Orange Glow Wood Cleaner, one 22-ounce bottle of the multi-purpose cleaner, one cleaning sponge. Call 1-800-245-7766.
Introducing all new America Online 8.0. We listen to you and designed AOL 8.0 with hundreds of exciting new features. Like the new email sort to quickly identify important mail. And the smarter search so you can find what you're looking for faster. And better parental controls to help safeguard your kids. There are hundreds of new features to easily connect you to the people and things you care about most. New America Online 8.0. Call 1-800-4-ONLINE now.
Now, you can enjoy Canal Sur with all the news, sport reports, talk shows, entertainment programs, and much more. All of them from different countries in Latin America. Fresh, uncut programs as presented in the country of origin. Canal Sur, made in Latin America for Latin Americans. Sur, somos Latinoamérica.
Now available on Time Warner's digital cable.
We now return to radio on Modern Marvels. Television knocked radio for a loop. Overnight, TV did to radio what the talkies had done to silent pictures. Television had been put on hold during the war, but now came on strong as millions of young Americans, children of the Depression and weary of the war years, settled down and started living the American dream.
GIs came home with a lot of money in their pockets, and they found that they could buy a new medium for a new era, and that was television.
Many of the performers who had made their names on radio found new homes on TV. The public, intrigued with the idea of seeing their favorite personalities as well as hearing them, followed along eagerly. It didn't take long for television to usurp the evening hours from radio.
Radio appealed to the innocence in me. Television took it away. There's no innocence on television. It's right there in front of you. Rod Serling told me once, he says, you know, when I wrote for radio, I could write, there's a dark, foreboding castle at the top of a hill. And if you could say that with a deep voice and the right organ music, whew. If I write that same thing for television, two technicians come in and say, well, what kind of castle do you want, Rod? You want peaks? You want a little lights on? Where do you want the lighting to go? And I'm showing you the castle. Whereas radio, let me invent my own castle. Innocence.
The early 50s saw the networks. There were three by now rushing to establish superiority in the new medium. For a time, radio floundered, seeking to reinvent itself. The public had demonstrated its preference for television in the evenings, but that left mornings and afternoons open. Car radios had become every bit as popular as the cars themselves, and TV could not very well invade that territory. At last, radio found a new direction by playing to its strengths.
TV, I think, probably did radio a favor, because look at radio today and look at radio in the Golden Age. In the Golden Age, in the 30s and the 40s, it thrived, and there were shows on radio. All of a sudden, those shows moved to television. And when that happened, radio didn't know what to fall back on. And then along came a guy named Elvis Presley and rock and roll. And all of a sudden, radio found itself and knew exactly the direction it should take. It was radio became local, radio became music, and radio thrived.
Rock and roll saved radio. You're talking about a wonderful part of our culture that now is primarily in the automobile, the car. The car is the savior of radio.
The big advertisers moved to television, and the program budgets went with them. No longer were shows prepackaged for radio stations. The stations found themselves back where they had started in the days before syndication, with a lot of open time to fill. Gone were the soap operas, the spooky dramas, adventures, and familiar comedies. Gone to TV. All that was left behind was a turntable and a microphone.
And now let me tell you about McTavish's skinless weenings.
People still wanted music and news and weather and local information, so that's what radio became. Popular music became the top 40, and the station announcer became a disc jockey. Radio set about becoming what it might have been had the networks not jumped right in at the outset, as David Sarnoff had predicted in his memo more than 30 years before. Radio would play music and broadcast ball games.
Red Barber gave me baseball. He put it in my head. I saw the game. When I went to my first game, I was 10 years old. I walked into Ebbets Field. The grass. I knew that grass. Red Barber had explained that grass to me.
In October 1954, the first portable transistor radios began showing up in stores. The transistor had been developed at the end of the war by engineers at Bell Laboratories. It was far smaller and more inexpensive to make than the vacuum tube. The transistor gave radio another well-needed boost. Now it could go anywhere, to the beach or the picnic or the ball game. By the late 50s, for each television set owned in the U.S., there were three radios. FM's moment finally arrived in the mid-50s when stereo recordings and stereo record players debuted on the market. Stereo provided two channels of separated sound, which greatly enhanced the listening experience. FM, with its wider bandwidth, was capable of transmitting and receiving these stereo signals with very high and low frequencies. As listener interest in FM increased, the number of stations grew to meet the demand, to the point where FM stations outnumbered those broadcasting in AM. As stereo sound advanced, listeners became more sophisticated and discriminating in their listening tastes. While AM clung to the increasingly younger top 40 listener, the more educated, affluent listener switched to FM, and the advertisers followed them. FM, with more stations, divided itself into formats to more specifically target a desired group, thereby offering clearer alternatives for advertisers. A station that broadcast romantic songs might appeal to a younger female audience, while a harder-edge album rock formula would be more attractive to males. AM, in danger of losing the entire adult market to FM, found salvation and new life in a format called simply talk. The average American household has 5.7 radios. However, less than 2% of the population acknowledges radio as a vital source of information. Radio will continue in a moment on Modern Marvels.
Tonight at 8, a Navy ship and her crew does an incredible vanishing act.
Hi, Billy Mays here for OxiClean, the stain specialist. Activate the stain-removing power by adding warm water. Use OxiClean in a solution to take out spots and stains. It even takes grape juice out of your favorite cotton shirt. Chlorine bleach can damage your clothes. With just one splash, you can ruin a pair of jeans. OxiClean is odor-free and safe on your colored fabrics. OxiClean, the stain specialist. Use OxiClean on carpeting. It eliminates red wine, pet stains, and neutralizes odors. Iodine, coffee, red wine, on the clothes and in the water. Add OxiClean. It removes the stains without the damaging effects of chlorine. Call now and you'll get a whopping 4-pound bucket of OxiClean, the squirt bottle and the super chamois. Not $20, only $9.99. Here's how to order.
Call to order the 4-pound bucket of OxiClean for only $9.99. You'll also get the squirt bottle and super chamois with your order. Call 1-800-455-4848. Call now.
Craftsman has come up with another smart solution that simplifies projects and saves you time. The Craftsman Speed Lock Drill and Driver System. This patented Speed Lock Quick Connector is the heart of the system. It fits any drill and works with keyed or keyless chucks. The Speed Lock's simple click-in, click-out action makes changing bits so easy you can do it with one hand without rechucking. Speed Lock lets you do even more with this combination drill driver. Drill a pilot hole and countersink. With a quick flip, drive in the screw straight and flush without changing bits or tools. Choosing the right tool can make any job go more smoothly. At just $29.99, the Craftsman Speed Lock system is essential for anyone who owns a drill. And because it's from Sears, your satisfaction is guaranteed or your money back.
Call now to order your 31-piece Craftsman Speed Lock set for only $29.99 plus shipping. Call 1-800-840-6996.
If you have a tax problem or owe money to the IRS, please stay tuned for some important information. The IRS is now reconciling back-owed taxes, liens, levies, payroll taxes, even penalties. If you act now, the Seidemann Law Firm can settle your IRS debt for just pennies on the dollar. Don't wait until it's too late. Call the Seidemann Law Firm now and settle your IRS problems for only pennies on the dollar. Don't be another IRS victim. Call today for a free confidential tax analysis.
Call toll-free now, 1-800-354-3400.
Tonight on the History Channel, despite America's high-tech arsenal, the Viet Cong caught them off guard by hiding in a web of tunnels. Camouflaged and protected by booby traps, they dug lairs for hospitals, beds, and weapons. And from the headquarters far below, they launched their surprise attack, the Tet Offensive. The Tunnels of Vietnam on Modern Marvels. Tonight at 10, only on the History Channel.
We now return to radio on Modern Marvels.
Thank you so much for calling News Talk 760 WJR. Julie from Maumee, Ohio. Julie from
I think people Ohio. Live vicariously through other people's lives through radio. And radio broadcasters know this. They know by putting people on the air, just listeners on the telephone, giving their opinion, that they will capture the imagination of people just listening vicariously.
As more listening alternatives appeared on the radio dial, the audience became more and more fragmented. More choices for advertisers meant that stations had to compete harder for their share of the advertising dollars. Rating services like Arbitron and Birch began to poll the listening public to find out who was listening and to what station. Broadcast industry broke its audience down into categories according to age and sex and income. The analysis was called demographics.
Today, radio is really ruled by this, Arbitron. Arbitron is the rating service that is used to measure ratings for radio. The ratings will indicate who's number one, number two, number 10, number 15 in different age groups. And the advertising community uses that tool to decide how much advertising or whether to place advertising on radio stations. There's very few stations left where the disc jockeys pick their own music. And I'm reluctant to burst that myth, but this is the case. The music is pre-programmed into a computer, and the computer is told by a music director how to rotate the songs. What is happening is people want immediate gratification. They don't want to have to wait for one type of music form to end before they can get another when they know they can press button number two on the radio and get that exact music form.
I think the rating system was perhaps the most crippling influence on not only radio but television. I think there has been altogether a dumbing down, and that's a terrible thing to happen.
It's after 8 o'clock.
We're here, we're queer, get used to it.
It's strange, isn't it, that in a lifetime you can see the birth and the demise of an industry as we knew it. Of course, radio is stronger today than it ever was so far as commercials and whatnot are concerned.
In the future, you're going to have an all-blue station, an all-reggae station, an all hip-hop station. And that's it's reflective of the sophistication of the rating service.
In 1962, the satellite Telstar was launched into orbit, and the communications networks were boosted into space. Soon, dozens of satellites were orbiting the Earth, relaying and amplifying signals from one station to another. Phone conversations, radio and television programming, computer data, all signals riding on radio waves. Today, life without radio would be unimaginable. We use it for information and entertainment. Radio waves cook our food, open our garage doors, and allow us to communicate down the block or far into deep space. Remarkable that Marconi registered his patent for wireless barely 100 years ago. Perhaps the reason we take radio for granted is that we understand instinctively that it has always been here in the air around us. Radio is not so much invented as plucked from the air. It is hard to consider how far radio has come in just the 20th century without wondering what marvels await us in the next and realizing just how fast we are rushing to meet the future.
For the answer to these human problems, listen in tomorrow, same time, same station.
Time marches on.
They turned the tide of the Revolutionary War. Their stealth and skill have turned every battle since.
I'm not some crazy person. I'm out there in defense of my country.
Josh Binswanger looks at this controversial aspect of military training. Snipers. All this week at 9, 8 Central on the History Channel.
Where's the best place to find anything about history? HistoryChannel.com. Any topic, anytime. Where the past comes alive. Online.
Now, an exclusive home video offer from the History Channel. You can own the program you've just seen for only $24.95 plus shipping and handling. To order, call 1-800-708-1776 or shop online at historychannel.com.